at Impri. Namaste and greetings. I, Reetlat, researcher at Impri, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav Evang Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nayi Delhi, extend my warmest welcome to you all to Impri Web Policy Learning. Today marks the inaugural day of Diplomacy and Foreign Policy Cohort 2.0, an online international spring school program, a one-month immersive online certificate training course. This training program is organized by IMPRI, Center for International Relations and Strategic Studies. So let's begin with a concise overview of the program. In an interconnected world where nations continually engage in complex interactions, the course on diplomacy and foreign policy emerges as a vital compass to navigate the ever-evolving landscape of international relations. At its core, this course is an exploration of how nations communicate, negotiate, and collaborate in the pursuit of their interests while avoiding conflict. It uncovers the art and science of diplomacy, revealing the intricate strategies and diplomatic tools that skilled diplomats employ. Simultaneously, it delves into the formulation and execution of foreign policy, deciphering the principles and practical steps that underpin a nation's engagement with the global community. Therefore, a well-crafted foreign policy coupled with skilled diplomacy can lead to a more peaceful and prosperous international relations. Whether you are an aspiring diplomat, policymaker, international relations scholar, or simply an enthusiast seeking deeper insights into the world of diplomacy, this course promises to be a transformative experience. So now the themes of the program are as follows: Introduction to Diplomacy and Foreign Policy, Negotiation and Problem-Solving Skills, Soft Power, UN and Multilateral Diplomacy, Digital and Tech Diplomacy, Economic and Trade Diplomacy and Foreign Policy, Military Diplomacy and National Security, Geopolitics, China and the Indo-Pacific, Conflict Resolution and Feminist Foreign Policy, and lastly, Global Political Economy and the Evolving World Order. The chair for the program is Professor Swaram Singh Ji, Professor and Chairperson, Center for International Politics, Organization and Disarmament, CIPOD, Jawaharlal Nehru University, JNU, New Delhi. This program also has an excellent panel of experts who will be sharing their expertise for the duration of this program. The distinguished expert panel includes Ambassador Shashank Ji, Ambassador Reeva Ganguly Das Ji, Major General Dr. P.K. Chakravarti Ji, Professor Sumit Ganguly Ji, Ambassador Partha Ray Ji, Professor Shrikant Gondapalli Ji, Professor Meenal Srivastava Ji, Professor Prabhir Dey Ji, Ms. Nandita Bharwa Ji, Professor Sangjukta Bhattacharya Ji, Dr. Parma Sinha Pale Ji, and lastly, Captain Alok Bansal Ji. We are grateful to have such an esteemed panel of experts with us. The panel of convener comprises of Dr. Simi Mehta Ji, CEO and Editorial Director, IMPRI, and Dr. Arjun Kumar Ji, Director, IMPRI. Proceeding further, I welcome all the participants to this enlightening deliberation and thank you for being interested and putting your time, energy, and efforts into understanding emerging issues pertaining to diplomacy and foreign policy, while helping us to bring together the practitioners and participants through this course for impactful policy research and action. We have also shared course outline and reading resources in your email for your kind perusal. Before we start today's session, I would like to remind the housekeeping announcements once again. Please join the meeting on time. There will be a Q&A session after each presentation. Share your questions on the Q&A box. The questions must not be posted as anonymous attendee. Ensure that your questions are precise and refrain from making general comments in the question to save time. Now, without further ado, we will be starting our program. So there's a slight delay. We will be starting off in a couple of minutes. Meanwhile, for our participants who have just joined in, I will be repeating the about section as well. Again. So, in an interconnected world where nations continually engage in complex interactions, the course on diplomacy and foreign policy emerges as a vital compass to navigate the ever-evolving landscape of international relations. At its core, this course is an exploration of how nations communicate, negotiate, and collaborate in the pursuit of their interests while avoiding conflict. It uncovers the art and science of diplomacy, revealing the intricate strategies and diplomatic tools that skilled diplomats employ. Simultaneously, it delves into the formulation and execution of foreign policy, deciphering the principles and practical steps that underpin a nation's engagement with the global community. Therefore, a well-crafted foreign policy coupled with skilled diplomacy can lead to a more peaceful and prosperous international relations. Whether you are an aspiring diplomat, policymaker, international relations scholar, or simply an enthusiast seeking deeper insights into the world of foreign policy and diplomacy, this course promises to be a transformative experience. Now, we will be starting our program. It is my honor and privilege to invite the chair for the program, Professor Swarnam Singh Ji, to start the program with his opening chair remarks and an overview of diplomacy and foreign policy. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. I hope I am visible and audible to all of you.
Yes, sir.
And I must sincerely begin with an apology because I was stuck somewhere in something personal and I was trying to reach back, but sometimes traffic can be an issue. I'm delighted to be part of IMPRI's second cohort on foreign policy and diplomacy, and I can see overwhelming response. I believe some of the participants may have had direct or indirect feedback from participants of the last inaugural cohort of diplomacy and foreign policy. We had a very energetic and enthusiastic group of participants last time, and I'm sure this time again, the cohort two participants will be really very, very energetic and engaging in our discussions. My compliments to IMPRI team also. You know, I was just hearing your brief outline, as you mentioned to the participants, the relevance of this discussion and immersive engagement with diplomacy and foreign policy. I sincerely want to underline that participants themselves also make this program very, very interesting. And very often, very interesting perspectives, very interesting new issues come on discussion. Thanks to participants who often come from not just a whole range of different locations, and then they bring their own perspective depending on where physically they are located, in which city, or affiliated to which institution. But I think it's also interesting that sometimes they also bring the weight of their disciplinary background, depending on which discipline each of the participants are trained. Some of them may also be working or may have had some work experience. So participants enrich the discussions, and just as IMPRI ensures a whole range of very, very celebrated, erudite experts that will come and have a discussion every evening with the participants. So usually the first thing I also often mention is that those participants who can switch on their videos, at least in my session, I prefer that participants should switch on their videos if they can, so that the discussion becomes far more interactive. One can feel speaking. Thank you. I can see one participant has already switched on his video. So if more participants can come alive on screen and we actually see each other, and technology allows us now to be able to see each other, then the discussion becomes far more lively and interesting. And of course, we will have detailed lectures as the list is already with you now. But discussion part to me becomes increasingly fruitful, not just for the participants, but also to the speakers. Very often speakers have their own takeaway from each of these discussions that we have. Now, let me quickly pinpoint, I'm sure some of the issues were already flagged in the opening remarks to you, as to why so much more focus is visible now increasingly on issues of diplomacy and foreign policy. To begin with, many of you must be very familiar with these terms that we are using. If some of you come from a very different disciplinary background, then diplomacy is only a communication paradigm. It's a tool for foreign policy to become effective. Or shall we say, diplomacy calibrates and molds external environment around our country or around any country which is conducting diplomacy in such a fashion that it makes it easier for that country to pursue its foreign policy goals. So foreign policy has some principles, foreign policy has some goals, and task of diplomacy, thank you. I appreciate some of the participants who are switching on their videos. Now it looks like I'm having a conversation rather than speaking to a blank screen. So I appreciate and I thank all of you who are switching on your videos. And please feel free, I'm a teacher, feel free to interject me at any time, because the whole purpose of IMPRI's immersive cohort 2 on diplomacy and foreign policy is to make sure each of you have a takeaway from these discussions. It's not a certificate course that will, you know, just add one more line on your CV. It should help us in transforming your worldview, transforming your way of looking at things around you. And therefore, make sure you have a takeaway from each of these discussions, and not just me. Feel free to interject and ask any question or make any comment. And so that the purpose is you have a takeaway. You think you learned something from these discussions. So to go back to what I was saying, diplomacy is simply a tool in simple fashion, or as we say more technically, it's a communication paradigm tool where you use communications. There is no other tool in diplomacy. It's only conversations. You use that communication paradigm to create or calibrate your external environment of the country in such a fashion that it should help a country to pursue and achieve its foreign policy goals. Now, foreign policy is, of course, driven by several things, like your heritage is very significant, because our heritage often largely molds our identity. And if some of you are from international relations, you know that, you know, scholars who are described as experts on constructivism, they tell us that our identities determine our interests. For example, a policeman's interests are likely to be different from an army man, or a professor's interests are going to be different from a craftsman, because we identify ourselves in a certain fashion, and that identity determines our interests, and interests then determine our initiatives. So foreign policy is largely driven by who we think we are. What is India? That determines what kind of goals will be pursued in India's foreign policy. Other than the intangible part of my identity or India's identity, which is largely driven by culture and civilization, then there is also physical elements of my identity. I could be 7 feet tall, I could be 5 feet tall, I could be 200 kilos, or I could be 75 kilos. Physical elements or traits or features also determine. So is a country landlocked country? Is a country archipelagic country like Indonesia is? Or is a country with a long coastline? Where the country is located in South Asia, West Asia, because neighborhood matters, that also determines identity of a country. Then, of course, out of these grow some basic principles. Each country has some values that it really attaches very, very high priority. And those are the things that together formulate your foreign policy. Then, of course, third element is history. What is the historical location, not just our location in terms of spatial location, space-wise, but also time-wise our location. India became independent soon after Second World War. That has an enormous influence on what India thinks is an important foreign policy goal. For example, disarmament, arms control became very important goals for India's foreign policy, because India became a newly independent state soon after Second World War, and United Nations was being set up at that time. India became a founding member of UN even before India became independent. India organized something called Asian Relations Conference even before India became independent. So time and space both influence also foreign policy goals. So this is, one is foreign policy, and diplomacy is a tool to pursue that foreign policy goals. And how is India's diplomacy or the global debates on diplomacy? How is India's foreign policy? What are global debates on foreign policy? How is India engaging in terms of its formulation of foreign policy or actual operational use of diplomacy in its relationships with either multilateral organizations or major powers or emerging powers or neighborhood? All these are going to be discussed over the month of April with you. And I think this is going to be a very lively discussion. I again, deeply appreciate people who are having their videos on with me. And if others want to also switch on videos, are most welcome. And I keep repeating, if you have anything in your mind, don't wait until, because, you know, I'm an old teacher, I could continue talking for a long period of time. So if you want to interject and ask anything, please do. But let me continue what I'm saying. So this is diplomacy and foreign policy. Why it is that diplomacy and foreign policy is no longer something that should interest only experts on foreign policy or people who are in foreign service. Foreign policy and diplomacy today is of interest to everyone. Even if you are a artisan, you are a musician, you are a dancer, or you are in a corporate sector, person, anything. And very simple reason for that is that world has never been as intensely connected in real time. We are all connected globally. I'm sure all of you are already aware of the earthquake in Taiwan that just happened a few hours back. Our connectivity is unprecedented, which means our awareness about not just our planet, but about our universe, about the multiverses, is exponentially intense. And that influences all of us as to how we think, what is the correct way of doing my job on my desk. Because your exposure is unlike ever earlier. I mean, I sometimes say your grandfather, and I'm sure some of your grandfathers were unusually erudite or global cosmopolitan, but let me just caricature in a simple fashion. Your grandparents must have taken 10 years to gather information that you can gather in 1 minute on your phone screen. Now, what this means is that you are processing data and your brain is processing data that human mind has never before processed at that speed and scale. So, therefore, whatever you do in your real life, you are no longer in a bubble of your own. You're connected to everything else around the world. Sometimes you're connected so much that the state is not even able to know how much you are connected and how much you're influencing. In fact, now we have a new term called influencers. Not because they are authorized and empowered by any state machinery, but simply because they're connected with the rest of the world. And that connectivity influences everything that we do, whether we are a sports person or business person, it doesn't matter. Now, why I'm saying so? Because that means that whether you like it or not, you are constantly engaging with issues of foreign policy and diplomacy. Indeed, the challenge for diplomacy and foreign policy is also exponential and unprecedented. Because let me say, in a lighter vein, each one of you are contributing to foreign policy. Because if you have connection with thousands of people around the world, you are an ambassador of India for them. If they don't know much of India, whatever you say is the final truth. So each one of you become ambassadors of India. If you have a friend in Tuvalu or Burkina Faso or in Saint Kitts or Ukraine or even Argentina, someone who lives in a remote place and has little interest of India, but you're connected to him online, you are the ambassador of India for that person. He believes India is whatever you tell him. So therefore, not just each citizen, there are sister cities now. Cities have sister cities. Then, of course, there's a mayors have their own networks and associations. Even at the union government level, let us take an India's example, each ministry has its own foreign policy. Education ministry has millions of connections worldwide. Sports ministry is participating in Commonwealth Games, in so many other sports bodies they are connected with. They are part of many global sports initiatives and multilateral organizations. So indeed, every institution, whether it is university or it is corporate sector or it is religious organizations, there are thousands of temples of India in United States. They have networks. So that means the challenge to understand foreign policy, the challenge to conduct foreign policy, the challenge to conceptualize foreign policy is exponentially different. So, at best, what we say is what Ministry of External Affairs, if we have to look at India's case, is doing is largely ensuring that it is constantly defining what is the broad bandwidth within which India's foreign policy has to be understood and operationalized. They cannot go into each of the nitty-gritties as to how each of you are connecting with other people around the world, or how my university or your institution is linking with other institutions around the world. They cannot, it's not possible anymore. But their task is to broadly define the broad bandwidth within which, if you step outside that bandwidth, then you will be discouraged, disincentivized, or even punished. So there's a broad national interest that defines the broad bandwidth of foreign policy. And of course, we also know that in diplomacy, diplomacy also has developed many new genres. What you see very often on television is example of summit diplomacy. National leaders are constantly traveling and meeting either in bilateral channels or in multilateral channels, or sometimes at multilateral channels, they are meeting on the sidelines of that multilateral meeting, one-to-one meetings. So national leaders, particularly when you have very powerful national leaders of powerful countries, they inordinately influence how foreign policy is conceptualized and how diplomacy is operationalized. Your example of Indian Prime Minister is very, very obvious here. The hyperactive footwork that Prime Minister does in terms of traveling, schedules are very, very hectic, and personal bonhomie, informal interactions. So in diplomacy, summit diplomacy has become unusually visible and even effective part of how diplomacy is conducted. Which also means that in India's case, for example, Prime Minister's office in a great way influences foreign policy, not just Ministry of External Affairs. National Security Advisor would have a great role in foreign policy because foreign policy also addresses national security challenges. And security is not just confined within our borders. Security is connected around the world. There are over 25 million Indian ethnic Indians who are living around the world. And India has become increasingly conscious about our responsibility to ensure their safety. Any tensions happen, India has to step out. So from 1991, Gulf War, India has set an example around the world of being a country that ensures safety of its citizens, brings them home from war zones. And you saw the recent example of Ukraine. Many of us, including me, did not know that there are 23,000 Indians in Ukraine. And India made sure it again reinforced that example of ensuring safety of Indian citizens. The last foreign minister, Sushma Swaraj, had brought a very personal element to that connect with overseas Indians. She would personally tweet and connect with Indians in distress around the world and take initiative to provide them safety and protection wherever required. So that was a very personal approach to connecting with overseas Indians. Now, Prime Minister, of course, as you see, he addresses Indian diaspora wherever he goes. And that has transformed how the world looks at Indian diaspora. No longer snake charmers, but now mouse charmers, computer mouse charmers. And Indian diaspora increasingly is asserting its identity. They are happy to say, I am from India. And that means they are becoming a bridge, they are becoming an important link, they are becoming very, very important source of wielding influence in countries where they live for India's foreign policy. So this transformation of foreign policy and the consumption of foreign policy by each of you makes it relevant that if you can really have some basic understanding of what foreign policy is, what part of foreign policy impacts you, what part of foreign policy you are impacting. Time and space shrink, as we say, it was never like it is now. And therefore, more and more people are becoming engaged in at least having a basic understanding of foreign policy, just like more and more people are now used to using keyboard rather than pen or pencil. We have all become skilled. None of us now say, oh, I don't know how to write on screen by using the keyboard. It's a must skill now for most, at least professional people, or even and the use of phone, for example. And that connects people, whether it is online payments or it is WhatsApp communications. That connectivity is very, very unusual, and that is how you are influencing performance. Now, diplomacy is also seeing that a whole new, different group of people are to be employed in diplomacy. Some of you may be familiar that nation states were created after 1648 Treaty of Westphalia. Before that, also, there were ambassadors. They were often referred as plenipotentiaries. Plenipotentiaries were ambassadors who had enormous authority to take decisions on behalf of emperor or king. And that was required because communications were very slow and poor. It took 6 months from India to go to London until cables were laid in the ocean, and then, of course, telegram is possible now. So initially, usually the kin and kith, relatives of the emperor, would be appointed as plenipotentiaries to go and live in another neighboring country or country of concern and ensure that there was a peaceful or productive relationship between the two countries. And very often, I jokingly say, in that time of diplomacy, the essential qualification for being a plenipotentiary ambassador, or ambassador in residence, as they were called, was not only that you must be kith and kin of the emperor or the confidant of emperor, but you should have good handwriting. Because if you write something that will reach the emperor after several weeks or months, if it is not good handwriting, emperor may not read it. And you have to write it yourself because these were confidential documents. And of course, you also have to be, what I jokingly say, good at cocktails and tailcoats. Cocktails and tailcoats. If you remember, old Europeans used to have long coat with a tail behind. You have to be comfortable in carrying yourself in that kind of very special dress. And of course, you should be good at cocktails because you want to break ice and be more informal and reach at some agreement. It is all about bargaining, communication paradigm to bargain that you are able to pursue your interests and take others along with you. Now, gradually over a period of time, diplomacy has become a professional service. So diplomacy is both noun and verb. Verb when it is seen as a process. Noun when it is seen as a professional service. Now people are trained over a period of time, then they go through several mid-career trainings. They have to constantly keep up with developments. And I think increasingly in future, you will have diplomats who will be specialists. For example, if two countries are, or more than two countries are negotiating on law of the seas, or they are discussing some kind of a nuclear agreement, or they are discussing issues of patenting, healthcare vaccines, then you need people who also have a technical knowledge on the subject. So increasingly, diplomacy around the world is also becoming not just a professional communication paradigm-driven activity, but also is bringing in people who are specialists. In United States, for example, very often you see a lot of people from universities join as diplomats. And of course, when the government changes, other party comes to power, they move back to universities. But this also means that your full professional service in diplomacy also needs ministers who have to be far more professional. So you notice now you have in India a foreign minister who is a professional diplomat. We have had earlier also IFS people, Indian Foreign Service people, becoming minister. Hardeep Puri was minister before Jai Shankar, but in another ministry. And in Ministry of External Affairs, usually junior ministers were former diplomats. First time now we have a cabinet-ranking Minister of External Affairs who is a professional diplomat. And you have noticed how well he fits in, because that is all he's done all his life, diplomacy. So he doesn't need any briefing, any notes, any things to read. He knows how to conduct himself. And therefore, for the first time, I dare say perhaps around the world, but definitely in Indian history, a serving foreign minister has published two books on foreign policy in 3 years. So you have a very professional person conducting foreign policy. Now, of course, his skills are professional skills, which will become effective more or less depending on how is India perceived by other countries, how is India engaged by other countries. So it doesn't mean he has a magic band to solve all problems, but he is a professional person, and I think he fits the bill very well here. And he's able to conduct himself very easily because he's trained in diplomacy. So therefore, you will increasingly need people who are far more professional and trained in foreign policy, because they have to constantly be watchful of where is India going. And India is not necessarily going where the Union government wants to take India. Indian population is taking India in a certain direction. And we all know India is a very young population. Half of India is under 25, I'm told. And all these youngsters are very tech-savvy. Technology is a multiplier of whatever you want to do. You want to sing in your bathroom is one. You can upload that same song on social media, on YouTube, and you will have million hits. So social media is another important transformer of our everyday life, including foreign policy. So your prime minister has some 30 million people as followers on Twitter. And he can communicate with other heads of state on social media in multiple languages because technology allows that. You can wish head of state on his birthday in his language. I'm sure all of you do that all the time. But imagine how much bonhomie and chemistry that adds to. Of course, social media also throws up challenges. So therefore, foreign policy and diplomacy are becoming exponentially large canvas, both wide and deep, because any issue and every issue is now on everybody's table, including your table. But you may not respond. You may have responded. Maybe if you have a friend in Taiwan, I have some friends in Taiwan. I wrote to them immediately. I hope you're safe. I pray that you're safe. But Indian Foreign Office today has to respond to anything happening in any corner of the world, because it is instant response. And if you do not respond for an hour, then perhaps nobody is waiting for your response, because so many others have already crowded the space for responding. Now, with that kind of young population, with that kind of India, which is now seen as emerging, see, Indian narrative on foreign policy today says India is transforming from being a balancing power to a leading power. That is the template within which foreign policy is being conducted. And diplomats feel empowered in that sense. They feel emboldened. I'm sure each one of you feel emboldened when you want to talk about India, which is transforming. Not for a minute I'm saying there are no problems. There are challenges. Always. Even United States has multiple challenges. They have drugs problem. They have Black Lives Matter. They have gun violence, all kinds of. It's not that there will be ever a stage where a country will have no problem at all. Countries will always have challenges. But how is India perceived around the world? That makes India far more engaged. India has to now have missions between the embassies and consulates around the world. More and more embassies and missions are being opened. More and more, professional people are being deployed or posted there. They bring to the table a whole new set of issues which were never in reckoning before. Now they are in the reckoning. And that response of India has to be constantly there. Now, when I speak of India, which is transforming from, see, in international relations, you hear a lot of these terms, great powers, superpowers, hyperpowers, all kinds of emerging powers, middle powers, leading powers, balancing powers. These are all coinages which all have specific meanings. So when you read some of these newspaper articles or you hear somebody speak about India, depending on what term are they using. So great power is a coinage that came about after Industrial Revolution, primarily a little before also, because Industrial Revolution, which was driven because of several discoveries, but most important discovery was steam engine. Steam engine led to creation of naval fleets. And naval fleets allowed those small little European countries that were constantly fighting with each other all these years, hundreds years, the 100 Years' War, 30 Years' War, religious war, this war, that war. With naval fleets, their focus shifted to outside. So the whole era of colonization started. So they stopped fighting with each other in Europe. They would go out and fight with each other in India, in China, in Africa, in Latin America, somewhere else. So in Europe, they had peace and prosperity because now they were fighting all over the world with each other, trying to control the rest of the world. That kind of growth of these European countries led to a coinage called great power. Great powers were called great powers because they could influence events around the world. So they, the like British number one family, it's a family, it's a private family, but head of that family, even today, is a sovereign head of 15 nation states. King Charles is king of 15 nation states even today. He doesn't represent UK, he represents his family. It's a family, and head of the family is head of UK and 14 other nation states. Just like one East India Company had occupied India till 1857. Imagine if Amazon or Microsoft was to declare that they are occupying 30 countries and they are making a union of 30 states. They can colonize. I'm not saying they will. Sorry. So sometimes we don't imagine why somebody says great power. Great power means power that can influence events around the world. It primarily came from naval fleets, but also many other assets. Then in 20th century, you heard another term called superpowers. Superpowers were primarily outgrowth of nuclear revolution, states that had nuclear weapons. Soviet Union and United States had thousands of nuclear warheads, sometimes 70,000 put together, which could destroy this planet several times over, not once. So many nuclear weapons that they could destroy this planet several times. Now that means they had power to influence events around the world, but that made them great power. What made them superpower? They had that capacity to influence events around the world simultaneously at multiple places. Therefore, they had to be called different not just great powers, but superpowers. And then, of course, Soviet Union collapsed. There came a moment of United States being described as sole surviving superpower. But that period saw United States in 1990s decade behaving like an uncontested leader of the world. It would even ignore United Nations, it would skirt United Nations, go and do things the way it wanted. So there was a French foreign minister, Philippine. He called United States hyperpower. So he coined another term called hyperpower. Then, of course, now you are hearing about emerging powers, you know, BRICS nations, for example, sometimes called emerging powers. Sometimes you hear term of middle powers. But to come back to India, the current debate on foreign policy, India is shifting from balancing power to leading power. Balancing power when India was largely playing as non-aligned leader, that you wanted to balance between East and West, ensure stability by playing a role of the third party, balancing between two grand military alliances that they don't end up in a World War III. Now, one block has collapsed. So somebody said non-alignment is irrelevant now. The non-aligned movement is still there, but you see India is non-alignment is not the central focus of India's foreign policy now. We have moved from non-alignment to multi-alignment. So India is today following multi-alignment foreign policy, which means building partnerships in as many sectors with as many countries as possible. A good example would be Middle East. Countries that don't talk to each other, they all are partners of India. Iran, Israel don't talk to each other. They're both friends of India. UAE, Saudi Arabia had huge problems. Egypt, countries that are having difficulties with each other, they all. So that is India's new approach to build partnerships in as many sectors, with as many countries as possible. It's called multi-alignment. And we have moved away from old-fashioned independence of foreign policy. Non-alignment was built around the axis of independence of foreign policy to now strategic autonomy. That means we want to ensure autonomy in the long run. In the short run, tactical maneuvering can happen. So once in a while, to please United States, India can vote against Iran in UN Security Council. But in long term, you want to ensure your strategic partnership with Iran. So that kind of transformation is happening, which is where now we have become leading power. Now, what is leading power? Since I'm not hearing anybody interjecting, I will continue. I'm happy to continue. Leading power is not yet a great power. Great power has what we say in international relations theory, system-shaping powers. We all live in an international system. And system we define as something that is more than the total sum of its parts. Like your automobile. Your automobile has thousands of parts which are so built together that they perform a function. If you separate each of these parts and then you join them differently, they will not be an automobile. They will not deliver what automobile delivers. So they have to be put together, shall we say, calibrated together in a certain fashion that they will deliver an outcome. So system, therefore, has something more than the total sum of its parts. Similarly, international system, which has nation states in it, which has multilateral organizations in it, we have all kinds of multinational corporations in it, many, many actors together make international system, but the way it is organized, the system has something more than the total sum of its parts, is what we are saying. And system is constantly changing, transforming, sometimes more active, sometimes less active, some areas more active and some areas less active. And therefore, outcomes of what system produces are largely controlled and determined by great powers. Otherwise, we say all 193 countries have sovereign equality, but in reality, you understand United States is the most powerful country. So United States and Bhutan are both sovereign equal countries, one vote. But we know United States and Bhutan are very different powers. So United States has capacity to influence outcomes of each process. Now, leading power has influence. Leading powers are those powers that are recognized for having influence. And influence primarily in ensuring as to what will not happen, what should not happen, what will not be allowed. So leading powers primarily have influence in ensuring that they can influence the course of action, but they may not influence in terms of determining the outcome. When they become capable of determining the outcome, then they become great powers. So you have to be careful as to when you hear somebody saying India is a great power, you should know India is not yet recognized as a great power. Heart of heart, emotionally, I can say India is great power. But experts in international relations, experts in foreign policy, they think India is now becoming a leading power and potentially can become great power. Now, why I'm saying all this? Because when India is moving from balancing power to leading power to a great power, then India's engagement with the world is going to be constantly increasing. So our leaders will spend more time, will spend more resources, will have more focus on issues that some of you may think are not relevant to me. If there is an economic decline in, let us say, Haiti or in, you know, some faraway country in Latin America or Africa, why should I bother, is it? But when you are being recognized as a great power, then global challenges also become your challenges because there is expectation from India. And therefore, when India and India's leadership will spend more time, effort, resources, attention in addressing regional and global issues, it also must convince, train, and explain each of the voters to know why are they doing that. Otherwise, voters will get angry. They will throw the leader out of power. So each voter must understand why the precious resources of this country need to be invested in addressing regional and global issues. Partly because India is also, like many other countries, is getting connected with the rest of the world. There are issues that cannot be solved within India's borders. In fact, I often tell youngsters, you know, I'm sure many of you know this, if you close your eyes and put your hand on your heart and think of top five challenges that India has, you will find that not one of those five challenges India can tackle on its own. It applies to everybody, even the United States. Challenges like pandemics. You cannot close pandemic because, you know, here is your border and pandemic will not enter here. Challenges of climate change, challenges of terrorism, challenges of human trafficking, stealing of IPRs, any challenge you think. All challenges now increasingly need connecting with several other countries, sometimes in the whole of the world. So you now notice India has something called International Solar Alliance. More than 130 countries are now partners in that. Last September, India launched a global biofuels coalition. These are all climate related. Or initiatives like disaster resilient infrastructure building. India is sharing its innovations, which are DPIs, digital public infrastructure, for free. Anyone can take it. You know, historically, advanced technologies were not easy to get countries that made some invention, discovery, they will not easily share with others. Or it will be very costly if you want to receive it. Now India is creating a new model. We'll say, here is a new platform we created, online payment or e-commerce or anything. Anyone can take it. So that's a new template. In fact, new template. Yes, somebody has. Someone is trying to say something, or is it by mistake that your mic is on?
So I think that's my mistake. I think you can carry on.
Sure. So basically, just as India also starts to participate more and more in regional and global responsibilities, India will also start contributing to reconceptualizations as to how global governance has to be conducted, how process of decision making have to be different. And that is where India's influence is becoming visible. Now, if there are greater expectations from India, India is going to play a greater role in what is happening around the world, then each of the citizens must constantly be aware of whether it is the correct dose of engagement that India has, whether that engagement is leading to the outcome which is beneficial for India. Because Indian leaders not only have to explain their actions in high moral principles, they have to also explain those actions, initiatives that they are pursuing in terms of utility of those actions. Voters want to know that it is a good act, but also useful act. Not a useful act, but bad act. No, it has to be morally sound principle guiding India's foreign policy, but also utility-wise useful for India. They have to explain that it is also useful. And that process has been going on gradually. For example, when you look at 18th century war fighting, foreign policy is all about ensuring peace to begin with. And then if you are at peace, then prosperity. If prosperity, then of course, you begin to talk about norm entrepreneurship, which means there are norms that should guide our behavior. Then values come, etc. But first thing, they have to deal with the reality of war. War for a long period of time was only a business of soldiers. Nobody else had to worry about it. And sometimes there were also mercenaries. The king will give some fiefdoms, some villages, some territories to some lords on the promise that if war happens, they will supply 500 youth for fighting on behalf of that empire, that kingdom, or that principality. It is post-industrial revolution that we started having standing armies. Standing armies, meaning you will be soldier even in peacetime. Even if there's no war going on, you will still be employed as a full-time soldier. And that has a correlation to the whole industrial revolution. Industrial revolution made it possible that workers will live separate from their families. It's artisans lived like families. In artisans' home, everyone contributed to the product. There was a main artisan who created, let us say, furniture, but little children, old parents, his wife, his cousins, everybody did some contribution in making of that product that he made. It was a family enterprise. Factories led to a very different reality where machines were producing and you had to produce 24/7 because machines never get tired. You need workers in shifts now, 8 hours shift. Three shifts.
Yeah, I'm allowed. Oh, yeah, I'm audible, sir.
So for the first time, you had ghettoization. You had young people, men, just living together, 20 in one room, next to factories. Families far away in some remote village. And that imagination led to creation of salaries, creation of banking, creation of currencies, and creation of professional armed forces that would be in place even in peacetime. Now, that is again changing now. So in Persian Gulf War, for example, United States hired about 180,000 people from what is called private security companies. So there were American soldiers fighting, but then there were also people from American security companies fighting in that war. Subsequent many wars in Afghanistan also.
So I have a doubt.
Yes, please. I'm happy someone has a doubt, has to say something. Yeah.
So can we take the example of Wagner Group in Russia or the Houthi rebels which are currently fighting, like indirectly it's Iran backing. So can we take it as an example of mercenaries?
Absolutely. I'm happy someone is so much aware. And Wagner Group created a huge crisis in Russia, if you remember. They became so powerful that they thought they could actually challenge the state itself. State where the leader is seen as a very powerful leader, and even insinuations that, they were going to take over the state. So that kind of powerful mercenaries being created, because otherwise, war in international relations and foreign policy studies is described as organized and authorized use of violence by a nation state. That means nation state has to declare that they have authorized their professional institutionalized armed forces to go and inflict violence upon another country. Now, when you have mercenaries, they are not state forces. They are not fighting for the flag. Soldier fights for the flag. He's not fighting for any other reason. He's fighting for honor, national honor, national flag. But mercenaries are fighting for money. That is why in 18th century, siege was the main strategy in war fighting, because they didn't want to kill, didn't want to get killed, just siege so that they can keep earning money. Now, what is most interesting in Ukraine war, they created a whole new category called volunteers. At least private security companies have an address, have a license, have their head office, follow some legal rules of the country where they are located. But volunteers are volunteers. You don't know who they are. Both Russia and Ukraine said, we will give you citizenship if you come and fight on our behalf. And both claimed they have over 10,000 volunteers. Now, these volunteers are unidentified people. They could be anyone. And that is going to upset the social fabric, that is going to upset the very institution of war. So what I'm underlining here is complications of international relations are constantly increasing also. Whole new sorts of challenges are coming our way. And foreign policy has to address that. So when Indian Foreign Minister in September of 2021, I think, in Samarkand, told President Putin that this era is not era of war. That line was repeated by at least half a dozen other world leaders. It was inserted in at least three final declarations, which is an endorsement or acknowledgement of India being seen as a leading power with an influence. When Indian Prime Minister says something, there is a constant echoing of that sentiment that happens around the world. Or later in Hiroshima summit of G7, Indian Prime Minister said, no nation should be allowed to voluntarily change national boundaries. It was again read around the world as something meant for Ukraine, because on east of Ukraine, Russia had identified three areas as new nation states that only Russia has recognized. So therefore, I think India's participation, not just the world is changing, not just the times are different, not just that you're connected around the world. What makes Indian citizens far more constantly up in the face, engaged with foreign policy, is the fact that India is also rising. India is seen as a rising power. We often hear India is the fifth largest economy, going to be third largest economy. That is a kind of multiplication of why each citizen have to be constantly aware of foreign policy and diplomacy. Because world is shrinking, time is shrinking. Of course, that applies to everybody. But not every country is rising. Not every country is every next day being looked upon with greater expectations by outside world. And
So,
therefore, yes.
I believe Sachin has a doubt. So, Sachin, you can go ahead.
Also, do let me know when you want me to stop because I should not hold them hostage for longer period of time. Yes, please. Go ahead with
Yeah,
your
thank you, sir.
comment on that.
My question was that what are the ethical implications of employing mercenaries as tool of tools of foreign policy, particularly in conflict zones or regions of instability like in Ukraine?
In a simple fashion, that is definitely disruptive. But war zones are only fields of disruption. So therefore, sometimes disruptive nature of mercenaries, disruptive nature of volunteers is not appreciated. It's like some country decided to drop two atomic weapons on Japan. But that was seen as justified after 6 years of Second World War, when, if there was a world war for 6 years, you think war will continue until last man standing is dead. It's like pandemic. You were not sure when it will end, how many people will have to still suffer it, how many more will die. So circumstances sometimes make it justified that you want to allow mercenaries, you want to allow volunteers. But I, as a teacher, I, as someone who looks at institution of war, finds it enormously disruptive. But disruption, as you know, in your generation, has also become a positive word. Disruption is no longer seen as a negative word. Disruption is now seen, it came from economists, where disruption is seen as something that catapults market forces into new calibration to become more productive. But now disruption is being applied in all other fields to, be seen as something which triggers innovation, which triggers out-of-box thinking. So disruption itself is seen as positive spin-off. And from that perspective, I'm open to understanding that yes, it could make war more contemporaneous in that sense. War also has to reflect what the reality around us is today. We are no longer in 19th century world. We are no longer in 20th century world. 21st century is very different. And therefore, war will also evolve over a period of time. War will also become different. And market forces are definitely becoming far more powerful in 21st century. In fact, I often say that in 17th century, we had a mercantilism. First, we had Protestantism, which means Renaissance in Roman Catholicism. And Protestantism meant that work is worship, life is here, and I'm allowed to make my life more prosperous here rather than focus on my next life. And that Renaissance in Christianity led to mercantilism. Mercantilism led to rational thinking and beginning of modern ages. And that led to Industrial Revolution to colonialism, and so on. So life has been constantly evolving, is what I'm underlining. So also our world around us. Exactly, war also has been evolving. So war has to reflect something which is contemporaneous. And because in 17th, 18th, 19th century, nation state was largely creation of market forces. Merchants, once they started producing more and more because of machines, they had to sell it far and wide. They were not selling only in their own village or in their own county or in their own country. They were now sending across Europe. There were threats from pirates, from, thieves on the way, all kinds of other people. So institution of nation state was created that will provide security for flow of trade from one part of the world to the other part of the world. So market forces primarily, among others, were the reason nation state was created. But 20th century became so destructive, it's the most destructive century in human history, that state became inordinately powerful. And it started controlling the market. State will decide what will happen in market or what will not be allowed to happen in market. So in different nations, for example, some sectors were disallowed for free market. Some sectors only nation state will control. Other sectors, okay, anyone can open a shop. But even there, you need a license, you need all kinds of controls. Now, in 21st century, it appears that market forces, because of multinational corporations, have become very powerful. And they are reclaiming the state, that we created the state to be subservient to us, not our master. To give you a simple example, multinational corporations like Amazon or Microsoft, you know, their gross value is $3 trillion. $3 trillion. If they were to tomorrow declare that we want to call ourselves nation state, we have decided we will call ourselves nation state and not multinational corporation, they will have ninth largest GDP on the planet. Ninth largest GDP. So imagine the power that market forces now have, and they are reclaiming the state. So therefore, look around the world. World leaders are increasingly much more conscious of protecting market interests. So the fall of communism, among several other reasons, is partly because, in a very caricatured, simple fashion, there are a lot of nuances in, but if I have to make something stereotype and simple, left-leaning communist left parties have always stood for workers' rights. They've always stood for redistribution of resources, focus on equity. But now if you see the leaders around the world, rise of right, you hear around the world, rise of right is protecting the wealth of that nation in that sense. The focus is, I'm saying it's very simplification I'm doing, but that is how things have transformed over a period of time. So market therefore is now reclaiming the state. And national leaders, one after another, around the world, United States, Turkey, wherever you look at it, they have to be far more careful of not hurting the core interests of the market in that sense. And that is, again, something that has to be understood by India, which India is transforming. India is not static. What happened to us yesterday, how we did things yesterday, is not any longer good for us anymore today. Partly because world is changing, but much more. It is like, have you gone on a river rafting, for example? The sole principle of river rafting is that your boat should be faster than the current of the river. Because if you are equal or slower than the current of the river, then river will decide where you go. If you have to take control of your boat, then your speed of the boat will be faster than the current of the river in which that boat is. So likewise, India is being transformed because world is transformed. But India is also transforming at the same time. So India's engagement with the world has to be far more intense, far more deeper and better understood. So Indian citizens have to be, I often say that India has to prepare the world to engage with transforming India. But India also have to, at the same time, train its own voters to understand how not just world is transforming and India is transforming much faster. So India is transforming faster than the world is transforming. That is where India becomes a leading power. India potentially becomes a great power. And that requires that all of us will have to be far more aware of at least the basic things that India will be doing around the world, how Indian foreign policy will be conceptualized, how Indian foreign policy will be implemented, what India will be doing around the world, what India will be doing at home, hosting, you know, G20 meetings. We also often say the power of India is not just military power or economic power. In international relations, convening power is very significant power. To give you a very simple example, when you call, let's say, 20, 25 guests for a birthday party at your home, different birthday parties have different happiness quotient depending on how good host you are will decide how much people left after the party with how much of happiness, whether they were all extremely happy or they were kind of happy or they were not happy. Birthday party is same, 25 number is same, more or less food and expenses are same. So it is not just that India has economic capacity, money to host events. India's convening power is very significant. So you saw how India organized so many meetings. Roughly 100,000, 8 lakh, 100,000 foreign delegates visited India to officially attend events. So imagine those 100,000 people may have come to India before, but many of them may have come for the first time. And they go back with a certain imagination of what India is. Successive 220 or so meetings that took place before the summit meeting, and some meeting happened also after the summit meeting, 100,000 or more foreign delegates were formally invited to attend various meetings in 60 plus cities. 7 to 8 million Indians were engaged in hosting of those events. 7 to 8 million, 70-80 lakh. Whether they were providing tents or they were providing taxis or they were providing printing banners or they were serving tea or they were, you know, officials or they were advisors or they were advertisers or they were television crews, sabko milaka, 7 to 8 million people were engaged with these events. The personal attention that at each stage Indian leadership was trying to provide, showcasing of Indian culture, Indian cuisine, Indian costumes, Indian history, that convening power. Two good examples to understand what impact. I see one hand up, I will just come to you. Two things that I want to underline you must notice is one, India hosted the summit meeting and before the formal sessions began, Indian Prime Minister invited African Union, which constitutes 55 countries, not just to propose that they should become members, no, to come and sit and formally join as a member, making G20 after 15 years as G21. This is structural change. It is no longer G20, it is now G21. And the 21st member is 55 countries put together represented here. Not only G7 powerful, but those who are in the margins of international decision making are now sitting on the same table. That shows convening power. Second, most multilateral meetings, you can check one after another, they have to extend their last session so that consensus can be built on what is the joint statement they want to issue. Because it is not difficult, it's not easy to come to an agreement with 20 countries to know what is the text of final declaration. Before the first inaugural session ended, India issued the final declaration. That is the convening power. India is ambitious. India knows it is India's opportunity because India is going to stay young and active and thriving maybe for 2-3 other decades. Then we'll start growing old, we'll start shrinking population, focus will shift to Africa. So this is also a historic opportunity for India, and I think Indian leaders are aware of that. Let me now stop. I see one hand up, and please go ahead and make your comment or your question. Please ask.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So actually, sir, I just wanted to take up from the point on India's transition from being a leading power to from a balancing power to a leading power. And in that context, you mentioned about you know, Prime Minister making the statement to Mr. Putin that this is not an era of war. But is that really an accurate description of how things are shaping up? Because the trajectory seems to be clearly in the opposite direction. So is it more of an wishful thinking, or you know, it's a process of acting as a noble great power, or a Vishwamitra as we call, or delusional. I understand that we want to have a more, as you say, convening power. We want to have good relationship with everyone. But does it come at the cost of not being accurate with the state of play around the world?
In foreign policy, we often face a dilemma. And that dilemma is that you come across things that you see as desirable, but not feasible. That happens in everyday life also. Each one of you very often see things that you believe are desirable. For example, many of you youngsters may want to buy an expensive car or expensive dress or go for a holiday to some foreign country. That is desirable. You want to do that, but you want to postpone it. And you know, maybe this year only visit some not too far away place, maybe Bhutan, or maybe if you're in south of India, you want to come north of India or east or west of India, because you think that is feasible. You don't want to have nothing, you want to have something, hoping that you will gradually move in that direction where you see your destinations as desirable. So a fundamental dilemma that at every stage in foreign policy also, nations face issues where they have to make distinction between what is desirable and what is feasible. So here, when statement is made that this era is not era of war, it is an expression of normative thinking. It is to say, this is good behavior. That it is not desirable to use violence to resolve issues. Perhaps we should only use dialogue. But of course, reality is different. You're only saying this is what is desirable. But then you're not severing your relationship with Russia if Russia doesn't stop the war. See, then you look at feasible. What is feasible? You said that, but you are not saying I will have nothing to do with Russia from tomorrow onward because I said this era is not era of war and war is continuing still. So desirable and feasible. And India, again, you notice, has now started becoming relatively more assertive. And this is a combination of many things. A, India, as I keep saying, is increasingly capable because we have young population, we have a large middle class, we have a political stability. World wants to come and invest in this country because they think they will have better per dollar returns because we are the fastest growing large economy. We have a very tech-heavy population. We have produced one after another examples of cost-effective innovations. I'm not saying everything is fantastic, but there are several positive examples. We have 100 plus unicorns, if I'm right, in startups. So these are examples. India is, I think, third largest unicorns in the world now. So that makes India definitely far more attractive, and the world is beginning to listen to what we want to say. And that is making us far more assertive also because of another reason. The parties that ruled India before BJP came to power during Vajpayee's time and now during the last 10 years, those parties that were in power were largely Congress, Indian National Congress, and other friends and allies of Indian National Congress. And shall we say that Gandhian influence was the mainstream? There were other voices, no doubt. Many other voices existed, but Gandhian thinking was perhaps far more mainstream. And that also happened because first 17 years, Prime Minister Nehru was in command and he was himself very influenced by Gandhian thought and philosophy. So that kind of, and again generalizing, as I said, there are other voices, that kind of thinking largely focused on non-violent solutions to peace, dialogue, writing letters, you know, making non-alignment kind of focus. even during that time, if you look at the leaders who are now described as right-leaning groupings, all of them from the very beginning had relatively stronger sense and stronger interest in wielding power. They were never in power, but their desire was there. So when Vajpayee in the 60s came to join as a member of parliament, even then he was saying that India should have a nuclear weapon. And when he came to power, he gave it high priority. And, you know, we often say that perhaps in the 13 days when he was prime minister, then because of one vote, he had to, you know, resign and go for elections. Even during 13 days, he was focused on detonating nuclear device. Not that nuclear science, of course, was created by Nehru, Mrs. Gandhi and others. There were stories of possibilities of tests happening in 1986 and so on. But the commitment to wield power, interest to wield power, existed in this group of leaders who are now in command. They have full majority. And then India is also transformed. So it is but natural that you will see India in all sectors appearing to be far more self-confident, far more assertive. Not benign, far more assertive. Both have their own values. Being benign has its own value, being assertive has its own value. So that is how you now see the narrative changing over a period of time. Why I'm saying this is because you said India told President Putin this era is not era of war. But then we also explained to the world that our interests lie in continuing to work with Russia in areas where it favors India. When it helps India to buy oil, our imports of oil shot up because, you know, Russia was willing to give it for very good price and India wanted to use it. And everybody else also is following national interest. So when European nations lowered and almost stopped buying energy from Russia directly, they were buying oil from India. India was buying crude oil, refining it in India and exporting to Europe. So it's a pragmatic approach. Everybody is happy with that. So they understand that India will not tow American line or Russian line. India will tow Indian line. So that is the dilemma which any foreign policy faces all the time. And they have to keep balancing these things and ensure that the eye remains on what is India's national interest. And that should guide India's foreign policy. And that explains many other things that India is currently engaged in, be it in multilateral forums or bilateral relationships. Pakistan is another interesting example. I see one more hand. I'll just give you time to speak. Let me just finish this one stream of thought. With Pakistan, our foreign policy is very clear. Terror and talks will not go together. Right? But that is a normative position. When Taliban takes over Afghanistan, we see that local people are in difficulty. India wants to provide humanitarian assistance. We talk to Pakistan, and Pakistan provides land corridor for Indian food grains to go to Afghanistan. So nations follow this both desirable and feasible. What can be done and what narrative will be different. Same China. We are saying official policy, India-China relations cannot be normal until border is not normal, right? But we have a trade of $135 billion. Is that normal or not normal? Of course, trade is abnormal because it is one-sided. So constantly, foreign policy has to ensure balancing between desirable and feasible. Go towards desirable, but meanwhile, look at what is feasible in pushing your national interest. Yes, please, I see another hand up. I don't know if your hand is up by mistake.
Yes, sir. Yeah, sir, please. Recently the Ukrainian delegation visited India and the Ukrainian foreign minister clearly said that India needs to reconsider its ties with Russia as it's not the same as it was in the Soviet era back then in 1972. But now as Russia has clearly been recognizing the Chinese territory, Taiwan as a part of China, but the same words don't come for territories like POK and China is claiming in Arunachal. So, sir, do you think that it's the time for us to consider ties with Russia? And because there are no permanent interests in geopolitics, as we say, they're not permanent friends, they're only permanent interests.
Absolutely, you are right on it. India has repeatedly made it clear, you've heard Indian foreign minister say it so many times, that Europe thinks that Europe's problems are global problems, but global problems are not Europe's problems. He's also made it very clear several times that why should India take a certain stand because United States or Europeans want us to take that stand on Ukraine? Did they take India's stand when it came to India-China relations? They did not take India's stand. They took their own stand. So India will also take our own stand. So when it comes to Ukrainian foreign minister being hosted in India, that's a clear balancing strategy. India wants to communicate something to Western nations, communicate something to the Russian leadership as to where it stands. Because even when India was increasing imports of crude oil from Russia, India was constantly sending, you know, contingents of humanitarian assistance to Ukraine. And imagine 23,000 Indians were safely brought back home in middle of war. That speaks volumes of India's balancing with Ukraine and Russia. So unless both leaders of Ukraine and Russia wanted to allow India that safe exit, it would not have happened. In fact, India ended up bringing many other nationals also out of the theater. So that kind of balancing is what happens all the time, is much more visible now because India is more visible now. So whatever India does now, India has to be a little more careful because it is under huge scrutiny. For example, whatever United States does becomes a matter of global debate, right? So increasingly, what India does or doesn't do also becomes part of international scrutiny, and therefore much more care has to be taken as to what India does. And therefore, if India invites Ukrainian foreign minister, it definitely is to signal something to different stakeholders, both in the West and East. And that is something that India must have thought through seriously as to what are the implications of inviting foreign minister of Ukraine to visit New Delhi and foreign minister hosting them. So these are all sometimes gestures which are done intentionally to, you know, sort of communicate something to various stakeholders. So are we still continuing? What time it is now?
So I think there are some questions. If we
sure.
If that's all right. Anuragji, you can go ahead with your question.
Yeah, please. Yeah, I prefer that way, that you, if you have some questions, I should then focus on answering. Please go ahead.
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, I can hear
audible,
you.
Sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir. So, sir, while giving the example of a great power, so you mentioned how the invention of the he mentioned power had led to these countries of West trying to become great powers. But sir, if you look at history, the history of European colonization or its beginning, it began from the 14th century with the Treaty of Tordesillas. I mean, sir, the examples are the Portuguese. So by the 1560s, they were able to control the entire stretch of the Indian Ocean. So, sir, I had this doubt. Like, did the discovery of the century really, like, sort of start this era of, like, great forces?
Sure. Let me try and answer that. I was saying that in a conversation of an hour or so, one is broad brushing several things. So I understand Europeans had started going around the world even much earlier. Even in India, the East India Company started coming from 1600. And that's not when Industrial Revolution was happening. Industrial Revolution happened later. Except that they were going initially either as traders or as mercenaries. They became a political power or a military power once Industrial Revolution came about. And Industrial Revolution also resulted from so many innovations. I just gave example, which I think is the most potent in transforming them into military power. steam engines created naval fleets, and that allowed them to use enormous violence on several native people around the world and to forcefully control those people over a period of time. And that's why I identified as one. Of course, Europeans, I fully understand that they were going around right from the beginning of modern ages. So I gave example of mercantilism also, where the products were now going beyond their own village, county, country to other countries. So exactly. But imagine Indian products were going around at least much of what is today called Silk Road in ancient times also. Harshvardhana period, for example, in 300 BC, Ashoka or later. But at that time, trade was happening in value, not volumes. Steam engine allowed the trade to shift from value to volumes. Because on ship, you can make biggest ship possible and carry as much stuff as you want. So when trade was happening in value, then only high value commodities, all precious stones, precious metals, great artisans' products, silk, cotton, high value commodities would move from one place to faraway places, and great patrons like princes and kings and queens, they will be the one, or rich merchants will be the one who will be patronizing such trade at that time. So world was connected even before. I mean, if you go back to Homo sapiens, Yuval Harari's book, Sapiens, for example, talks about how all of us began from Ethiopia and went around the world over a period of time. So human movement around the world was existing all the time. And different phases, different reasons caused that kind of flow of people. But colonization primarily, see, even East India Company remained company. They over a period of time had started using higher doses of coercion, but they remained a trading company until middle of 19th century. Whereas Industrial Revolution had started 100 years before. And over a period of time, when company became a political sovereign, then the political sovereign felt contested. I mean, if King of England doesn't control this large colony and one of local company consortium is controlling that large company, that is not very fair. So the moment they got the first excuse or first war of independence, they said, we will directly take over this country now. And British were unusually smart. I mean, that is how they have real estate around the world even now. They two fundamental formulas in success of British colonialism. One, divide and rule. You've heard this again and again. Create divisions. Now, if you look at India, go back to Kautilya. Sam, Dam, Dand, Bhed. Bhed comes the fourth lowest priority. But for British, perhaps number one priority. Create Bhed first. Divisions. Second, create incentives that we will make you free. So 1858 Act came, and then of course many other acts came, then 1919 and 1909 Act came, 1919 Act came, 19. They were not planning to leave this country. Look at the real estate they were building here. They were not planning to leave, except that the World War created that situation. An enormous destruction happened in Europe, and they couldn't anymore manage it. And of course, during the World Wars, India has to, put condition, right? If you want to participate in your war, you want to commit something in return. And of course, democracy in the United States, American presidents had that influence. So over a period of time, they gave up that. But the coercion part, basically what I'm saying, came out of Industrial Revolution. And central symbol of that coercion was naval fleets. Because they could now take large armies and soldiers to wherever they wanted. They could just travel to all places and colonize those places over a period of time. So that is why I identified one. There are dozens and dozens of innovations that contributed to creation of Industrial Revolution. Yes, let's move to other questions now.
Yes, thank you, sir. Kishore Jhaji, I believe you had a question.
सर मैं ये जानना चाह रहा हूँ कि हमारे इंडिया का फॉरेन पॉलिसी हमेशा से बेटर रहा है, ठीक है सर, बट जब चाइना के टाइम में जब हमारा जो डिप्लोमेसी जो डिस्कस करते हैं तो उस टाइम में हमारा डिप्लोमेसी कुछ उसमें कुछ डिफरेंसेस आते हैं, वहाँ पे हम कुछ लो लो कुछ कम हो जाते, तो आखिर सर क्या कारण है कि ऐसा होता है? थैंक यू सर।
हाँ, धन्यवाद आपके प्रश्न के लिए। वो बिल्कुल, हम बार बार ये सुनते हैं कि चीन ने जो एक तरह से धोखा दिया 1962, 1962 की जो लड़ाई हुई, युद्ध हुआ हमारे साथ, उसमें भारत के नेतृत्व को शायद उस वक्त ये अपेक्षा नहीं थी कि चीन इस तरह से पेश आएगा भारत के साथ। तो उसके कई अलग अलग कारण कह सकते हैं। भारत में पहले देखें तो उसका मुख्य कारण ये कह सकते हैं कि 1928 में एक ब्रसल्स में जो कॉलोनाइज्ड सोसाइटी है, मतलब तो जो उपनिवेशवाद की जो विक्टिम है, उन सोसाइटीज की एक सम्मेलन हुआ था ब्रसल्स में, और नेहरू उस वक्त अपनी पत्नी के साथ स्विट्जरलैंड में थे, उनका इलाज चल रहा था। तो इंडियन नेशनल कांग्रेस ने कहा कि आप तो वही हैं, तो क्यों नहीं आप भारत की ओर से वहां हमारा नेतृत्व करें। ये मैं इसलिए कह रहा हूं कि 1928 से लेकर फिर उनकी मृत्यु 1964 तक नेहरू विदेश नीति में कम से कम आखिरी आवाज उनको माना जाता था कि वो करता धरता है एक तरह से विदेश नीति को लेकर। तो उससे शायद ये कह सकते हैं कि उनको ओवर कॉन्फिडेंस भी हुआ होगा, या लगा होगा कि मुझे बहुत जानकारी है विदेश नीति को लेकर। तो आज जो हम बात करते हैं कि कुछ दूसरी तरह की आवाजें भी थी कि चीन से हमें किस तरह से पेश आना चाहिए, वो शायद उस वक्त प्रभावी नहीं हो पाई क्योंकि विदेश नीति में नेहरू के बराबर का शायद उस वक्त व्यक्तित्व था नहीं, जब देखा नहीं जा रहा। इसी तरह से चीन के अंदर भी आप उसके कारण ढूंढ सकते हैं कि क्यों हुआ जो नहीं होना चाहिए था। चीन में भी आप देखें उस वक्त 1955 से शुरू होकर उनके सोवियत रूस से रिश्ते बिगड़ गए थे। वो अपनी परमाणु अस्त्रों की होड़ में अब अपने आप जुड़ गए थे क्योंकि उनको पहले लगा कि सोवियत संघ का जो परमाणु अस्त्र है वो हमारी सुरक्षा के लिए हमेशा हमारे को हासिल हो जाएंगे, पर वो नहीं हुए। तो उन्होंने फिर अपनी चीन ने अपनी तरफ से कोशिश की कि वो अपना एक परमाणु अस्त्र बनाए और कॉमिंटर्न से और रूस के साथ उनका एक तरह से तनाव हो गया, आपस के रिश्ते खराब हो गए। तो उसी वक्त चीन के अंदर एक ग्रेट लीप फॉरवर्ड इस तरह का अभियान चलता है, बाद में उसको सांस्कृतिक क्रांति भी कहते हैं, कल्चरल रेवोल्यूशन उसको कहते हैं। तो अंदरूनी जो उथल पुथल हो रही थी चीन के अंदर, वहां एक लिनपिओ अफेयर भी है, जो नंबर दो के नेता थे, वो उनका जहाज में दुर्घटना होकर उनकी मृत्यु हो गई, उसके बारे में बहुत सी अलग अलग अटकलें हैं क्यों हुआ कैसे हुआ। तो अंदरूनी तौर पे भी चीन में काफी उथल पुथल हो रही थी, तो वहां भी शायद ऐसा लगा कि अपने देश के नागरिकों का ध्यान बटाने के लिए कुछ और किया जाए, ध्यान दूसरी तरफ बढ़ाया जाए। तो जब भी किसी राष्ट्र पर युद्ध होता है या युद्ध का संकट आता है तो सारा राष्ट्र एकजुट खड़ा हो जाता है उस नेतृत्व के पीछे। तो इस तरह से बहुत से अलग अलग कारण हैं जो दोस्ती भारत ने चीन के साथ बनाई बनानी चाहिए, सोचा कि हम दो एशियाई संस्कृति हैं, सभ्यताएं हैं, और जो एशिया का रहने का तरीका है उसको हम बदल देंगे, इकट्ठा एकजुट होकर काम करेंगे, भारत चीन भाई भाई की बात हुई। तो उसमें जो विश्लेषण हुआ, जो अध्ययन हुआ चीन के बारे में भारत में, शायद उसमें कुछ कमियां या त्रुटियां रही होंगी, इसलिए वो अचानक फिर रिश्ते बिगड़ गए और आज तक वो तनाव बना हुआ है। पर ये भी कह सकते हैं कि उस परिपेक्ष में फिर वही जो हमने कहा ना कि फिजिबल और डिजायरेबल की जो बात हम कर रहे थे, उस परिपेक्ष में शायद जो निर्णय लिए गए थे वो शायद उतने गलत नहीं होंगे। कई बार 50 साल बाद आप किसी चीज को देखते हैं तो आपको लगता है कि नहीं, वो निर्णय ठीक नहीं था, पर शायद उस परिपेक्ष में वो निर्णय सोच समझ कर ही किए गए होंगे, और यदि कुछ उसके जो परिणाम खराब निकले तो उससे जाहिर है कि भारत ने बहुत कुछ सीखा और अपनी विदेश नीति में बहुत बड़े बड़े बदलाव उसके बाद लाए। मोटे तौर पर सैन्यकरण की जो नीति थी, जो जो रक्षा पर खर्चा करने की जो नेहरू की सोच थी वो ये थी कि हमें मिलिट्राइजेशन नहीं करना है, सेना के ऊपर बहुत ज्यादा हमें प्रभावी नहीं होना, उसकी वजह से उस पर निर्भर नहीं होना है। तो बजट कम था, फिर उस युद्ध के बाद बजट बहुत अच्छे से बढ़ाया गया, उसको सेना को सक्षम बनाया गया, तो बहुत कुछ सीखा भी भारत ने उस एक खराब परिणाम जो हुआ उससे। तो विदेश नीति में हमेशा ऐसे होता है कि कुछ आप अपना विश्लेषण करते हैं, फिर कुछ आप अपनी उससे नई शुरुआत करते हैं, कभी कभी वो शुरुआत बहुत प्रभावी होती है, कभी कभी प्रभावी नहीं होती है, क्योंकि आपके विश्लेषण में कहीं कोई कमजोरी रह जाती है, और वो हमेशा इतिहास में होता रहा है और शायद होता भी रहेगा। हमेशा देखना ये होता है कि क्या हमने उस एक्सपीरियंस से, उस घटना से कुछ सीखा और बदलाव लाया अपने विदेश नीति में या नहीं। तो मुझे लगता है कि काफी उसके बाद बदलाव आया, भारत का नजरिया वो चीन के साथ जो है वो बिल्कुल अलग हुआ उसके बाद। आज बहुत ही यथार्थवाद के नजरिए से भारत चीन से अपने रिश्ते बनाए हुए हैं, जिसमें व्यापार भी है पर तनाव भी है, दोनों चीजें साथ साथ चल रही हैं, और वो तालमेल मुझे लगता है भारत ने अच्छे से बनाया है उसके बाद। धन्यवाद आपके प्रश्न के लिए। मैं कुछ और भी, आई सी वन हैंड इज ऑफ योर अगेन, प्लीज गो अहेड विद योर क्वेश्चन, आई कैन सी ऑन माई स्क्रीन।
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. Just to carry forward the point that you'd spoken on the convening power of India, what I understand is in today's interconnected world, hosting a foreign delegation will, of course, provide India with the opportunity to strengthen international ties and showcase the indigenous capabilities of India. So it could range from the pre-visit planning to the post-visit follow-up. These visits often require meticulous organization, having cultural sensitivity, and if not anything, strategic communication. How do we justify all this when India is treading the path of or already riding the wave of change, especially challenges that it faces in the real estate sector, the post GST implementation, internationalization of rupee, or of late the water tables reducing, the inflation numbers that we see. So my question is, are we ready to take the center stage yet, especially on platforms where we are appointed as leaders of Global South, where I feel and that is what a majority population of India still feels today, as per various reports, that India or the center at New Delhi still needs to focus on more domestic issues than take up world problems for that matter.
Thank you. It's a very interesting question. India has to make choice of addressing domestic challenges before it gets distracted far too much in addressing global challenges. Indeed, during Nehru's time, this was often one of the criticisms, that Nehru was perhaps too much focused on global issues and sometimes neglected immediate neighborhood and sometimes also neglected domestic issues. But that is a natural thing. Any leader will be subject to such criticisms and evaluations. But what is interesting, you often hear that India perhaps never had the mindset to be a global leader. You hear sometimes that criticism. I'm not the one who believes that. Now, I believe that India always, if you remember your freedom struggle, freedom movement of India, also had links with several other Asian freedom movements. In fact, the role that India played in freedom of Indonesia, for example, or taking the Afro-Asian movement to Bandung Conference first, or connecting with Nasser and Tito. And so Indian leaders, whether India was independent or not, they were always global in their perspectives. And that you hear nowadays again and again, Vasudev Kutumbakam. That mindset of world is one family, that we are connected. हिंदी में आपने सुना होगा, सनातन में सभी प्राणियों में सद्भावना हो। सो वी एक्चुअली लुक बियॉन्ड ह्यूमन बींग्स। इन इंडियन ट्रेडिशन ट्रीज ऑल्सो हैव लाइफ, रिवर्स ऑल्सो हैव लाइफ। वी लुक एट वॉट जियोपॉलिटिक्स एक्सपर्ट्स टॉक अबाउट लेवेनस्ट्रॉम। टेरिटरीज आर लिविंग, टेरिटरीज आर नॉट डेड। And assets that territories have on upon them are also living and active, and they influence us. So the mindset of being globally connected was always there. To some extent, taking responsibilities of global leadership was also there. Except that I made a distinction that the leadership that ruled us, that saw Gandhi and Gandhian philosophy as mainstream, largely wanted to focus on normative nature of foreign policy, a normative method of growing as a global leader or global influence. We are now shifting to India becoming far more assertive and more conscious of wielding real power, whether it is economic power or soft power or hard power. The interest and understanding of power is different. But you can become global leader both ways in that sense. You can aspire to become global power. Today, India also has increasingly capacity. Material capacity also is increasingly with India. But yes, India has to constantly balance, because unless we make sure that our domestic challenges are addressed, we cannot address global challenges at cost of domestic challenges. But now I'm also saying that increasingly all your domestic challenges are becoming increasingly intertwined with global challenges. So you cannot disconnect yourself from global challenges and say, I will only focus at home within my boundaries. Because all our challenges, I did say earlier, are now global in nature. And particularly when you become a major power, India is the largest population country now. So sometimes I say, if we are able to provide security and prosperity to our own citizens, then 17% of the world is already taken care of. You know, we are a large population. But that 17% of population is now constantly connected in their activities, in their interests, in their occupations, in whatever they do and think. They are now increasingly connected with the world, because all our challenges are connected to working together with several other nations. The good part is that India increasingly has increasing capacity to influence and take other nations along with us. But the balancing of domestic and global has to be made by understanding that they are not separate, they are connected. So when we address global challenges, they have connection with how we deal with domestic challenges. When we deal with domestic challenges, it also has impact. For example, if you are able to remove poverty from India, then 17% of the population is no longer facing poverty or unemployment or disease or any such thing. So both are connected, and that balance has to be maintained. And balance has to be understood by every voter in India. Because otherwise, leadership will not be understood by voters what they are doing. That connection has to be understood by each of us. And that is where I'm saying, like, all of us need to be a little more aware about foreign policy diplomacy, whatever things we may be doing, because that has no influence on whatever I do. In fact, the book that recently came out from Foreign Minister, Why Bharat Matters, there's a whole chapter on it, on how foreign policy influences our everyday life and why we should be actually taking care of what foreign policy is doing and which way it is going, because that is going to influence as to how I live my life next day, next year, next decade. So if some of you had access, have a look at that chapter. That beautifully explains the link between world affairs and domestic affairs. Yes, next.
Thank you, sir. That rightly answers my question.
Yeah, thank you. Anyone else has questions now? Because it's already 8 and I am available. But if you want to close the session, let the host decide that.
So there's one more question from Indranilji. They've posted the question box. I'll just read it out. Yes, sir. Recently, India's practice of disaster diplomacy, wherein attempts to assess nations in the aftermath of natural calamities, has been lauded. Is this practice of bettering relations with nations in time of need a breakthrough trend in conducting diplomatic relations? Or have we been inspired from any nation in particular from history?
I'm sorry, you'll have to read it again. This is a little convoluted question. I should be careful.
Yes, sir. Yes, I'll just read it again. So the question is, recently India's practice of disaster diplomacy, wherein attempts to assist nations in the aftermath of natural calamities has been lauded. Is this practice of bettering relations with nations in times of need a breakthrough trend in conducting diplomatic relations, or have we been inspired from any nation in particular from history?
Thank you. I'm happy that one participant has used a very interesting term. Disaster diplomacy has been something also which is in vogue for discussions now. What is interesting is that disaster diplomacy has two sides of the same coin. In 2005, when we had tsunami, India, sorry, in 2005, when tsunami happened, India refused to take any foreign aid because so many agencies wanted to come and help Tamil Nadu area of India, Andaman Nicobars. India made a clear declaration, we are capable of dealing with our own crisis and we will not need any foreign agencies to provide any assistance whatsoever. Now that came from a sentiment that when foreign agencies come in, sometimes they begin to undermine national authority. Because national agencies begin to look like lazy, ineffective, and foreign agencies come with very different kind of resources. They hire local people who are willing to leave local NGOs and join these international NGOs because they get more money or different lifestyle or different way of working, different credibility. So there is a view that sometimes local governments might feel that it undermines the sovereignty and authority of their own agencies to allow foreign aid to come and address immediate crisis after any disaster. But India also used to receive foreign assistance when India thought that it cannot do things on our own and we need help from others. So it basically depends on national capacity and the nature and extent and magnitude of the disaster that one is dealing with. So if Japan can handle Fukushima crisis on its own, then it doesn't need anybody else. But if the crisis is such that local authorities cannot manage on their own, then of course international assistance has to be received. The second interesting element of disaster diplomacy is that sometimes nations seriously, sincerely offer assistance of humanitarian aid and assistance and rescue in case of disaster. But the host country, for political reasons, may not be willing to accept it. For example, when disasters happen in Pakistan, there are several examples. India makes a formal offer because we are the nearest next country. We can be the first to reach. In tsunami, Indian naval ships were the first to reach Sri Lanka, for example. Other countries, United States, are far away. They come to the help, but they take time. And in disaster, who reaches first is very important. But Pakistan, because of political reasons, will never accept Indian humanitarian assistance to deal with any of the disasters that happen. So disaster diplomacy, yes, it usually is an outproduct of pious, sublime sentiments which want to help out, go out and help. Haiti is often in news, I think recently again, Haiti was in news. So disasters can happen and other nations, those who have capacity, want to go out and help. But sometimes it also creates crisis of over, sort of subscription of help. So much materials flowing that local authorities also find it challenging to, really receive those things and make sure that nothing strange is coming, nothing unaccepted is coming. Each country has regulations as to what can be allowed to come in, what cannot be allowed to come in. Some countries are very strict about, sort of living things or flora, fauna, meats entering. So what kind of food is coming, cooked or uncooked, all kind of, sometimes those regulations come under enormous stress, how to receive so much of assistance in an area which has just faced a disaster. So it throws up all kinds of challenges. But as I keep saying in the end, because of rise of India, there are expectations of India. And one expectation, of course, is that in any disaster, India should go out and help other nations. And pandemic is not necessarily in that sense a disaster, but pandemic saw India going out and helping 100 plus countries. First, in terms of medicines that were seen as a curative, if not the perfect cure. Paracetamol, for example, was being sent around the world. And then we discovered vaccines. So vaccines were the cure. That cure was also provided to so many countries from India. So India has capacity, India has a desire, and other nations also have expectations from India. In which case, if both sides are happy to build that give and take relationship, I think disaster diplomacy is a very potent tool to build long-term friendships with other countries, because you go out and help them in their time of need. And that lays very strong foundations for a very fruitful relationship later. Thank you. I think we have had an excellent session today, and I'm looking forward. I think I will be coming back to have another session with you later. But I am sure that this cohort is as argumentative. They should gradually open up, and I'm sure this is our first interaction. Subsequent lectures will see you participating much more, hopefully. And I look forward to keeping tab of how discussions go from here. And when I come back to you, we'll have another long discussion again. And my best wishes to all of you. Keep your focus on ensuring that you have a takeaway from each of the sessions that you attend, because you are giving us your very precious time, and you must make sure that you use your time very well with us. For me also, I'm happy that I always have some takeaway from discussions that happen here. I cannot openly identify, but definitely I had my own takeaways from discussion today. And best wishes and my compliments to IMPRI and the team, which is constantly doing things very professionally. And I'm happy to see such a large number again joining this year's cohort too. So best wishes for the lecture that will flow from here. And depending on where you are, good afternoon, good evening, good night. And have a nice evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir,
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
for setting such a positive tone for the starting of this course. Your discourse has truly deepened our understanding and has also renewed a sense of passion and curiosity within each one of us. And especially thank you so much, sir, for taking the time out to answer every question with so much detail and patience. It was truly a privilege to have learned so much from you today. And we look forward to the honor of welcoming you back in our future events. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now we would be moving on to a quick introduction session with the participants. So if there are any participants who want to volunteer and introduce themselves first, you can raise your hands. You could mention the following, which is your name, designation, organization, location, why have you joined the course, and what you look forward to learning. Is there anyone who would like to go first, or I can just call on the names? Vaibhavji, would you like to go ahead?
No, ma'am.
Vaibhavji, you're not audible to us. Meanwhile, Anuragji, you could go ahead.
Ma'am.
Vaibhavji, you're not audible to us. Anuragji, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So am I audible? So namaskar, my name is Anurag Khan. I am from Guwahati, Assam, and I'm pursuing my PhD in international politics from Central University of Gujarat, and I have joined the course because seeing the large number of and the impressive I mean the mentors, and since that there'll be many I mean persons who have been active in the field of foreign policy practitioners who will be sharing their own knowledge of the field. So hence, I thought this will be a very wonderful opportunity to learn from these experiences. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anurag ji. Rahul ji, would you like to go ahead?
Well, thank you. So, good evening, everyone, and namaste. Rahul Sharma. I am from Noida, next to New Delhi, fully grown up. And I work in space of technology policy and data protection. I run my own consulting called The Perspective. And I have about 15 years of experience working with various local and global organizations in this space. My primary interest in this space, plus relevance of diplomatic know-how and how things are conducted in order to expand your global footprint in business terms. I think that is something I'm looking forward to, and also learning from, the faculty plus also the cohort who are coming from various diverse backgrounds. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Rahul ji. Rudraksh ji, would you like to go ahead?
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Rudraksh Juneja. I'm from New Delhi. I'm currently a law student and law trainee at Supreme Court. I'm also founder of a youth-led and independent think tank called The Geo Jurist Today. And I'm pursuing this course so that I can get more expertise in these subjects. Yeah, that's all.
Thank you so much. Anuradha ji, would you like to go ahead?
You mean me?
Yeah.
Anirudh? Yeah.
I'm
Okay.
sorry.
Yeah, no problem. It's okay. Hi everyone. I'm Anirudh Namjad. I'm from Karnataka. I'm in from Bangalore. And basically I'm a research fellow at Center for Health Diplomacy in Manipal. And basically I'm interested in this particular course to try to understand more a practitioner's point of view of diplomacy and the experts definitely, and it's an opportunity to learn and unlearn and relearn. I think it goes on. So it's the more you hear the experts and practitioners, I think we just keep on learning. So I think that's the main reason I joined this course. Thank you.
That's good. Thank you so much. Divyanshi ji, would you like to go ahead? You're not audible, Divyanshi ji. Oh, no, we can't hear you. Meanwhile, Maitri ji, would you like to go ahead?
Hi, Reet. Hi, everybody. Good evening. I'm Maitri Mishra. I am from Calcutta and I'm a chartered accountant by profession. So I used to work in an MNC in their corporate treasury domain. So given the fact that I got to start my career in corporate treasury, I developed keen interest in the interdependence of macroeconomics, geopolitics, and the market. Which is what led me to pursue foreign policy or diplomacy full time now. I'm a student of diplomacy and I wanted to take this course further to interact with you like-minded people.
That's
Thank you.
great. Thank you so much. Thulungana ji, would you like to go ahead? I'm sorry if I pronounced your name wrong.
Yeah, sorry. Hi, everyone. Yeah, good evening. My name is Tulungabasumtari. Currently, I'm based in Guwahati. I completed my integrated master's program from Humanities Department, IIT Madras. And for the last 5 years, I had been working with intelligence bureaus, some specific missions based in Myanmar, dealing with northeastern insurgencies. And as of now, I'm just trying to update some of my basic knowledge about India's foreign policies and diplomacy. And I'm studying with this course, and I'm doing some self-studies as well. Yeah, thank you.
That's good. Thank you so much. Sultana ji, would you like to go ahead? You're on mute.
Hello, am I audible now? I'm sorry. Yeah, hi everyone. I'm Sultana Mumtaz. I live in Bangalore. I'm a homemaker. Recently, I've decided to pursue a career in civil services by writing the examination for it. I aspire to become a career diplomat. So I'm hopeful that this course will help me gain some basic insights, given the wide variety, number of people, the panelists, the speakers, and I hope to gain the insights from their experiences.
That's good. Thank you so much, Sadhanaji. Is there anyone else who would like to introduce themselves? Kishore Jhaji, Ananya Sharmaji, anyone? Tashiji, would you like to go ahead?
Hello.
Hello.
Okay, my name is Tashi. I am from Ladakh. And so I did my master course in public policy. I'm more interested on India and China foreign policy. And even I'm working in organization on foreign policy and China, or India and China foreign policy. Yeah.
Yeah, that's really wonderful. Thank you so much. Ananya Sharmaji, would you like to go ahead?
Hello, everyone. So I'm Ananya and I'm pursuing my graduation from Lady Sriram College. And I wanted to refine my knowledge about India's foreign policy. And I think the course, the way it is outlined, it involved people who deal with it in their daily lives or have dealt with it. So I thought it would be good to join the course. Thank you.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much, Ananya ji. Abhishek ji, would you like to go ahead?
Yes, good evening, everyone. My name is Abhishek Chaudhary, and I recently completed my master's in political science from Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar University, Agra, and I've recently cleared GRF exam, and I'm going to get enrolled in PhD. And so I joined this course, so it will help me enhance my understanding of various domains of India's foreign policy and current geopolitical situation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Abhishek ji. Just read out the bit that Indranil ji has written. Hello, everyone. Hope you're all doing well. My apologies in advance to the host since I'm traveling and I'm unable to communicate via audio/video. My name is Indranil Das. I'm a PhD scholar at University of Delhi, researching on federalization of India's foreign policy and focusing on India's paradiplomatic engagements. I chose to join this MPhil course to gain insights from experts on the field to learn diplomacy in theory and how it translates into practice. I would like to learn how the experts and fellow panelists situate India's contemporary challenges in the era of uncertainty and aspirations in international relations. That's truly interesting, Indranil ji. Thank you so much for typing that. Now, is there anyone else who would like to go ahead? Divyanshi ji, would you like to give it a try again with your audio? Okay. I'll just read out the bit that Divyanshi ji has written as well. Hello, my name is Divyanshi. I'm from Sonipat, Haryana. I'm a first year student of MA Sociology. My interest is in governance and international relations. My interest in governance and international relations encouraged me to join this course. I love traveling and adventure sports. That is wonderful, Divyanshi ji. Thank you so much. Moving on, Ashish ji, would you like to go ahead? Sarah ji, would you like to go ahead?
Hello, everyone. I hope I'm audible. I'm sorry, my camera is not working at the moment. So I'm Sarah Rodericks. I'm from Mumbai, and I'm pursuing BA in political science from St. Xavier's College in Mumbai. So I joined this course particularly because I have a deep seated interest in learning about the intricacies of global affairs. And I thought this could be an excellent course because we have experts on this field. So yeah. Exactly.
That's great. Thank you so much, Sarji. Vaibhavji, would you like to go ahead? Okay. Sanchayji, would you like to go ahead?
So I'm Sanchay Dochak. I'm from Vishakhapatnam and I just finished my grade 10th. I started my grade 11th yesterday. And I am taking this course to gain some insights as well as knowledge in diplomacy and foreign policy, because next year it's most probably going to be my major. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Vahini ji, would you like to go ahead? You're not audible, Vahini ji. We could see your video, but you were not audible. Meanwhile, Nalin Singh ji, would you like to go ahead? Makalina ji, would you like to go ahead?
Can I speak?
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, just for introduction, because tomorrow I have a session.
Yes,
7 to 8, you know, forget about Ambassador Parthare. I'm an ordinary guy. My name is Parthare, right? So I'll be speaking. Hats off to you as a very youngster. You know, you are even younger than my own daughter. But you have been conducting this. I have been, you know, right from the beginning, I have been there. You have seen that I am there. Hats off to you. I would recommend that you sit for the UPSC civil service, because in India, if you want to be a diplomat, you have to go through UPSC. Otherwise, through NGOs, you can, but you don't go to that level. You don't become an ambassador. Or to all my students, I will say, tomorrow I will speak, today I will say that if you, they are very good. That the questions that they pose after this gentleman's speech from JNU, Sharma ji, jo bhi hai. Inka question jo karta hai, let me tell you from my heart out, you know, Indian Foreign Service guy, I have dealt with many Foreign Service officers, they do not have the capacity to question to that level. We have such good students in your cohort. In one, I was there. In cohort two, I am here. It's exceptionally brilliant.
Thank you so much, sir. That means a lot to me. Thank you so much.
So we'll meet tomorrow. Tomorrow I will be speaking after Riva Ganguly ji. You know, you have the program with you. Riva Ganguly ji was my boss for a while in Romania, from where she worked for a while. I was there for 3.5 years. And looking after Indian bilateral relations with Romania, with Republic of Moldova and Albania. So I'll speak. Thank you.
We really look forward to the session, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Makalina ji, would you like to go ahead?
Yes. Hello. Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, my name is Makalina Magama. I'm from Tanzania. Okay, and I'm a researcher. Independent researcher, actually, but currently I'm working with Oxford Police Management in Tanzania, and have joined this course just out of curiosity to know how the world operates in terms of diplomacy and foreign policy. So most likely I can say I'm here just to see or to know how the world operates. That's all. Thank you, and I'm happy That's to great. Be with you guys.
Thank you so much. We're really happy you could connect with us.
Thank you.
Now, I will read out Vaibhav Ji's message. Hello everyone, my name is Vaibhav and I'm from Kanpur. I am so thankful to the cohort to provide this opportunity to explore diplomacy at large scale. Thank you so much, Vaibhavji, for that message. Now, Ananya Sharma. Hello everyone, I'm Ananya Sharma. I'm originally from Delhi. I'm currently pursuing my master's degree in psychology from Tata Institute of Social Science, Mumbai. My interest in this course is purely based on curiosity and understanding of India's relations. I am facing internet issues since I'm traveling. Hope you all understand. It is good to be a part of such a diverse cohort and hear your views. Thank you. Thank you so much, Ananya ji. That's great. All right. Yeah. Is there anyone else who would like to go ahead? There is another message on the chat box. I'll just read that out. Hello, everyone. Sorry as I cannot join the audio and video at this moment. I am practicing advocate in Punjab and Haryana High Court in Chandigarh. My interests, this is from Nalin Singh Ji. My interest area is in international humanitarian law and also pursued master's in human rights. Thus, I'm here with you all to learn about international relations and diplomacy. Thank you so much, Nalinji. That's really interesting. Is there anyone else who would like to speak?
Yeah, am I audible?
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Ashish Gosain. I have done my PhD from the Center for Studies in Science Policy, JNU. I have also been a master's level specialization in international trade law. So I'm basically a law person who is interested in the area of diplomacy and international relations. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ashish ji. That was really great. Now, Kishore ji, I believe you had unmuted. You can go ahead.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kishore Jha. I'm from Patna, Bihar, and I'm just here as a teacher working. So I'm glad that I have joined this diplomacy and foreign policy courses, and I have good experience from all the professors and lecturers. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Kishore ji. Now I'll just read out a message from Vahini ji. Hi to everyone. It was wonderful to see all of you. I'm sorry about my audio. I stay in hostel and I have poor connectivity here. I'm Vahini, pursuing my final year BA LLB honors. I'm based from Chennai. My interest for the course is out of my interest for international law and international relations, and I plan to pursue my career in this field. Looking forward to other sessions. Apologies again. Thank you so much, Vahini ji, for typing that out. It's great to hear from you. Is there anyone else who would like to go ahead before we conclude the session? Seeing none, I believe we've covered everyone. We can now close the session. So as we come to an end of day one of Diplomacy and Foreign Policy, Cohort 2.0, an online international spring school program, a one-month immersive online certificate training course, I, Reet Lath, researcher, IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, would like to propose the formal vote of thanks on behalf of IMPRI, Center for International Relations and Strategic Studies, New Delhi. We are grateful to our experts for day one, Professor Swaram Singh Ji, and special mention to Advocate Prathar Ray Ji for joining in and for taking their valuable time and giving us an opportunity to learn from this online certificate program. We all thank our participants who have raised pertinent questions and actively participated in today's deliberation. Readings for the resource for the session have been shared in your email, and a video of the session will also be shared for your learning. We look forward to welcoming you for our second day of this certificate course on 4th April at 6 p.m. The theme for day two is negotiations and problem solving skills, soft power. And the experts are Ambassador Reeva Ganguly Das Ji and Ambassador Prathar Ray Ji. We are grateful if you're watching us later on YouTube or listening to us on our various podcasts or reading our publications. We hope you continue to join into our future in pre-web policy talk and web policy learning. Wishing you all a very good evening. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.